Namaskar, namaskar.
Welcome you from Dr. Raman Lohia, National Law University, Lucknow.
Thank you so much. And
evening, ma'am.
Good evening to all of you.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, ma'am.
Welcome, Madam Kanika Singh. Welcome.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I, Shubhangi Pandey, on the behalf of Legal Aid Committee and the Law Culture, welcome you all to today's webinar on the theme of women participation in judiciary and litigation. I am very honored to announce dignitaries for today's session, Justice Gyansudha Mishra, former Judge of Supreme Court of India, and Ms. Kanika Singh, Advocate of Delhi High Court. Now, I would like to request Ms. Kashish to tell us something about the law culture.
I would like to thank all the dignitaries present in the session for sparing time for this session. I would like to thank Legal Aid Committee of Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia National Law University for collaborating with us for organizing this session. We at the Law Culture aim to initiate, discuss, and articulate literature that is both accessible and comprehensible by professionals and laymen alike. The objective that we seek to imbibe is to widen the horizon of legal discussions by incorporating in our literature and deliberate the often ignored aspects of social strata. We further endeavor to highlight issues that are not just academically enriching, but also hold practical importance in the legal realm and public welfare. Founded by a group of law students from different law schools, we comprise of passionate researchers and fellows who are well versed in varied aspects of Indian and international law and public policy. Our team comprises of a dedicated body of editorial board and a highly acclaimed advisory board. We are thereby committed to enriching the public sphere by providing free access to research materials, decisions, laws, regulations, parliamentary reports, and other information that are not readily available or accessible. Once again, I would like to thank you all for sparing time for us from your extremely busy schedule.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I would like to request Vice Chancellor of Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia National University to present his opening.
Honorable Justice Gyansudha Mishra ji, Madam Kanika Singh ji, faculty members, committee members, dear participants. On behalf of Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia National Law University, Lucknow, I extend my hearty welcome to Honorable Justice Gyansudha Mishra ji. Madam, we can recall your judgments given in Aruna Shanbagh euthanasia case. You decided that Board of Cricket Control of India case also, very difficult case, but you decided it in a very cordial manner. Then very emotional judgment in Uphar tragedy case. It's our privilege to welcome you on behalf of National Law University, Lucknow.
Thank you.
Ms. Kanika Singh, young advocate. She is also member executive at the Delhi High Court Bar Association, product of Campus Law Center, Delhi, and also Lady Shri Ram College. She is first generation lawyer, and she has reached to the heights of legal profession, you can say, in a very short span of time. I welcome you also, and I welcome all the participants. Now, so far as the question of participation of women in judiciary and litigation is concerned, we start from law schools. In law school, the percentage of girls is going up, mostly in national law schools and also in the private law schools. I don't think there is an issue there. When it comes to profession, then in subordinate judiciary also, we call it PCSJ, the percentage is day by day is increasing. And roughly, we can say that about 25% of the judges in the subordinate judiciary are legal. But in the High Court, we have around 10% female judges. And in the Supreme Court, it's very difficult to count the percentage. It is less than 5%. It may be 1.5, it may be 2.5. But one thing is very surprising, madam. We have a collegium system. And in collegium system, the judges appoint judges. Even then, there is only token representation of female judges in the Supreme Court and in the High Courts. Coming to litigation, the senior advocates will not assign a very important or you can say crucial work to female advocates. It happens. I don't know whether they have less confidence in them or whatever may be the reasons. I don't want to go into them. Then there are cases of some harassment also. It may be sexual, it may be financial, but maybe other kind of harassment also. Then coming back to family, in family also there are family pressures, because all the parents think that the safest profession for women is teaching, or it may be medicine, or if one has entered into law profession, then it is better to go to the corporate world. Nobody would encourage the girl candidates to go for litigation or in litigation business. And then another hurdle, I don't want to call it hurdle, is marriage. Because sometimes marriage is a very pleasant thing to happen to life, but even if it is very pleasant, to keep it pleasant, sometimes the female advocates have to sacrifice their careers. That is also another point. But if the women judges are more on the benches, I believe that there will be some kind of improvement in policy initiatives. You can see policy improvements also. And I think public confidence will also be more in the women judges, because they go through the lived reality, what we call lived experience. So there is something which probably cannot be known by the male judges. I don't want to say that male judges are not gender sensitive. They are also gender sensitive. It doesn't mean that only women judges are gender sensitive, but there are certain things which are known to only women judges. It may be the realities of life which they can experience, or their experiences, not the personal, but in the community, also the experiences of women folk. So in that way, I believe that if the participation of women is more and more in judiciary and litigation, it would be good for the country as a whole, not only for legal profession and judiciary, but for the society. Thank you very much. Wish you all the best, committee members. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Now, I would like to request Dr. Samreen Hussain to address the dignitaries and enlighten us on today's theme. Ma'am, you're not audible.
Okay. Thank you, Shubhangi, and good afternoon, good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure and honor to be here, to be with a stalwart like Justice Mishra. Ma'am, I have been a fan of reading your judgments. And, you know, it's like, for me, it's a fangirl moment right now. So, and thank you for being, you know, a feminist voice in this world for us. Thank you, ma'am, for being here. No, ma'am, it's our honor and it's our pleasure to listen to you right now. Every girl who have dreamt to be in that place looks up to you. You are simply stalwart for us. You are our hero. So moving forward, as our VC sir very eloquently put, that the position, the participation in women in litigation and judiciary, the condition, I would like to add few more points. Sir talks about that there is we had almost 50-50 with regard to when we say in admission process. But when the same student after 5 years, when they go to bar council, the recent study of 2020 shows that only 15% girls get registered in bar council, 15%, that is the ratio. Then we go to the lower judiciary. The lower judiciary, the number of appointments with regard to munsif, they became a munsif, they become judicial magistrate, 25%. High court, the current high court, exact number of women in high court is 75. And there are three high courts which have no judges, no female judges. And then in Supreme Court, from 1950 till 2020, there had been only 8 female judges. And this actually, answers all our questions. Everybody is talking about ma'am's judgment in Schanberg and BCCI case. Amazing judgment. I would like to talk about a very simple judgment of ma'am in 2011 with regard to maintenance to a second wife in the case of Pyala Mulyadhanam, I'm sorry for the pronunciation, versus Pyala Puri Demudam. I teach this in my class. 2011, when a second wife was given maintenance, it's a rule that second wife is being called by Justice Kaju as a keep, a mistress, and not entitled, a concubine, not entitled to anything. And that is what we mean representation. That is the understanding of law. And that is how we want, why we want the participation of women, whether in, we call that judiciary or at litigation level, to understand the understanding of an issue which a women have. As simple as that. Understanding women's body is women's work. You cannot just put, you can empathize. Empathy is different from understanding. And I have this personal and very strong belief that we having women representation in judiciary is extremely important. We have numerous gender equal laws. The implementation is still lacking. We are going to hear about this from both Justice Mishra ma'am as well as Kanika ma'am. It will be an amazing session. I'm sure about that. But as a student of law, as a teacher of law for past 8 years, while reading judgments, I have been reading judgments with masculine interpretations. So I would love to read a judgment with feminist interpretation. And whenever I have a chance to read that feminist interpretation, it has mostly from when the bench consists of a women. I am not saying that, obviously there are gender sensitive male judges too. There's no denial to that. But the insight women give to law, and when we say the feminist jurisprudence, is actually very different. The condition, I don't want to take much time because I am really excited to hear to Kanika ma'am as well as Mishra ma'am, because Kanika ma'am simply being that in a male's profession, as Linda McCloy, one of the director at London, says that it's a closed club. Professional, the legal profession is a closed club, and she says this with regard to the UK judiciary, that she used 3 terms: male, stale and pale. So use these 3 terms, which is not very different from our Indian judiciary. They have the problem of gender, race, color, just add caste to it too in our situation, and you will have a perfect combination. So starting, I don't think Justice Mishra ma'am needs an introduction to people listening, but still, because I've been given this task, I would like to tell her that everybody knows she is a former Supreme Court judge. She has given several notable judgments, as our very own VC sir talk about, as I told you about, not a very landmark judgment, but according to me, which changed the scenario in how you understand maintenance laws, and which is very important. It might not be called the landmark judgment as regard to Schanberg or BCCI versus Srinivasan, but again, for a student of family law, for women, that maintenance judgment is very important. She has been Chief Justice of Jharkhand High Court, as well as served as Judge of Rajasthan High Court. Another amazing fact, she joined Bar Council in 1972. I remember when I wanted to study law in 2004, my parents were like, that's not a women's profession. What are you talking about? So she joining Bar in 1972, gave us so much hope, and shows her courage, fighting against that time of patriarchy. What we are fighting against and what she fought against, we cannot even imagine about that. So that is a humble introduction from my side. With regard to Kanika ma'am, as also sir pointed out, she is an alumni of one of the top universities in the world, you know, in India, that is TLC. She has, you know, again, she's a first generation lawyer, which is amazing. Then, you know, in fact, at such a young age, you know, she is so young and still so dynamic. She has achieved so much in for herself. She has, you know, dabbled in so many fields. She is also part of law culture. You know, it's a pleasure for us, for RML as well as for law culture, to listen to both of you guys. I'll pass the bomb back to you, Shubhangi, and I am really, really looking forward to listening to both of you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Now, I would like to request our speaker one to I'm sorry for the delay. Now I would like to request Justice Gyanpada ma'am to tell us something to impart the knowledge of the team on today's theme. Thank you, ma'am.
The respected Vice Chancellor of Ram Manohar Lohia National Law University, the distinguished professors of this institution, including Professor Samreen, who I heard just now, Kanika, the High Court of Delhi, all other participants, all other distinguished professors of this institution, and above all, listeners, participants, students who have linked themselves to this program. It is indeed a matter of great pleasure and satisfaction, more of satisfaction than pleasure, because I feel, you know, it's not a pleasure to discuss about the inadequacies of the women. So in all these, you know, deliberations and functions, I feel it's not really a pleasure. We should be celebrating the achievement of women. Rather, we have been still struggling to pull them up rather than, you know, promote them. And we have to, in the process, we have to think why their plight is like this. But in spite of that, I feel it's a moment of great pleasure that I'm able to associate myself the initiative taken by a premier institution in the state of UP, and I think UP is one state where I think, apart from others also, which needs to be sensitized about the gender, not merely in the profession of law, but also with reference to their security and well-being. I further appreciate the choice of subject for today's deliberation and discussion, which is participation of women in the judiciary and in the litigation side. Because you see, we are much of the, you know, the rather the food for thought, or maybe the points of thought have been mentioned by the respected Vice Chancellor Saab, mentioning the points, and he has put his, you know, thoughts like Gagar Mein Sagar. He has really given, condensed all the aspects of women's, you know, issues relating to legal profession, as to why they are shy of joining, why is there a judge in the higher judiciary. So taking the clue from that, and also from essentially from my experience, there is no denying the fact that women in the legal profession have not been encouraged even before the constitution was enacted. Before the constitution came into, it was enacted and was enforced, women did have the sense or the ambition or the thought to join the legal profession. And yesterday I was scanning through some of the articles, and a very good article I came across, where the history of the evolution of women in the legal profession was carved out. And I was charmed that many of the facts which I was, even at this stage, I was not aware, was, you know, included into it. And that is how I felt that the value of research is extremely important in this profession. It gave out how women had struggled even to get their enrollment done in the legal profession in the state of UP, in the High Court of Allahabad in the year 1922, then also in the High Court of Calcutta, and also in the High Court of Patna, where in spite of a law degree, they were denied the right to get themselves enrolled in the High Court. And there were cases, full bench, you know, full bench, I'm saying it for the youngsters, full bench means that all judges who are there in the High Court have to sit together and then decide on a particular issue. So the full bench decided and gave it an interpretation that if it cannot be confined to men only, but it has to include women also, because the word person would include man and a woman both. And I'm just giving you the condensed history of that period, like how women have struggled even to get themselves enrolled. Because, you know, if you go into the very ancient history, I need not go into that, because I'm confining myself to the subject. Like, what is the status of women in the judiciary and the legal and the litigation side? Litigation, as you understand, litigation would, you know, include where women have to go into the legal profession, where they have to argue cases. Like, there are different, you know, dimensions of a legal profession and litigation, but litigation is exclusively where you come into independent law practice. Please excuse me for a minute. I'll ask my staff to get me a glass of water. So, even for the, they had to struggle for getting themselves enrolled. But, hello? So, an enrollment, they had to struggle for the enrollment also. But fortunately, when the constitution in the year 1950 came into existence, which was drafted by the the Constituent Assembly, where members had influence of liberal Western education, fortunately. As they say, sorry for the interruption. So after the constitution came into existence, much of the struggle for women was reduced because equality for law, equality before the law and constitution came into existence. And therefore, I would really compliment the struggle of women during those days prior to the enactment of the constitution, where they had to struggle and they got themselves enrolled. And that is why we were having few very eminent women lawyers as barristers. Like in Patna High Court, there was one Dharamshila Lal, and there were very many, not very many, but a few women lawyers who got themselves enrolled in the High Court of Allahabad, Calcutta. I'm quite sure there must be in Bombay also, like chartered high courts. But that was just a seedling of the struggle. In spite of the enactment of the constitution, the attitude of the society towards legal profession was not very congenial, nor it was acceptable. And I have myself faced, you know, and that was a long way, because I completed my law in the year 1972. And when I had 3 years before, and I have been always been signaling a change, because the year I joined, that BL was converted into 3-year course, and that started, you know, called the LLB degree. So that the LLB degree, when I joined the profession, the law college, then I mean, even it's not that, you know, I fortunately for me, I come from a family of lawyers and judges. So I appreciate the concern of expressed in so many articles that even if women come in the profession, they have basically they have a background in the legal profession. That's very right. But fortunately, things have changed now. Even persons who are not from the in whose family there have not been lawyers and judges, they are doing well in the profession. But now, just to standing over the historical period, after that, you know, when I had joined the profession, there were only three girls in my college, four girls. Out of the four, I was the one. One opted out, she dropped out, she never completed the 3-year LLB degree, and three of us left, out of which it is very amusing to share this, you know, personal, you know, experience, that out of the three, one was a very good friend, one of the best friends of mine, who I told her, no, you have got to join the law, because how can I be in the college all alone? I don't know whether it's going to be another girl or not. So, and she joined. And she joined, she also completed, but she never came into this profession. But she also had a background, because her father was a lawyer. And in a lighter vein, her elder sister would say, I had heard so many reasons for doing the law, but had never heard a reason to give company to your friend you do law. So that was a very interesting part, you know, for her to join the law. And the attitude was such that one of the naughty guys in the college, he said, aap log kyun law karne ke liye law pad ke apne husband ko divorce karne ka irada hai kya? And I heard a similar comment in one of those articles where the woman said that lawyer in somewhere in south, maybe state of Tamil Nadu or something, some guy, you know, made a comment that you want to look for husbands. So that part, you know, what I heard in my family, I'll tell you. My father was, of course, very progressive about women. So he was way ahead, you know, at least he was 10, 20 years, you know, dur drishti, jisko kehte, he was that. So he didn't have any reservation about joining my law. But one of the uncles in the family, he started dissuading my father why are you allowing her to go to the law college? वहाँ तो सारे गुंडे आवारा पढ़ते हैं और हर any girl who joins the profession, and mind you, I'm not so ancient. I'm telling you of this history of 70s. वहाँ तो गुंडा आवारा पढ़ता है हर एक के if you join the profession एक 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 scandal बनता है. But I think temperamentally, I was, I always put my foot down whatever I wanted to do, and I had to tell them ki scandal ko hum paida karenge to scandal banega na. Why do we give them a chance? And during those days, there two or three women lawyers who were in the profession, they were misunderstood. I would say they were misunderstood because if they were working with the seniors, there was a story or a aisa etc etc. I mean, I'm telling you how the theory, I mean, evolution has taken place. And when I got enrolled in the State Bar Council, and in my family also, my father, in spite of his progressive ideas, did not allow me to start my practice in the High Court, because by that time we were in Delhi. And my father said, "Ki, all right, if you're still insisting, then you might as well go to the Supreme Court. Because the atmosphere is decent, etc., etc., and you can join the." Excuse me for telling you my autobiography, because autobiography also, gives you a clue of what when you reach a certain height, no one knows what struggle you have gone through. But I was not permitted to join the High Court. That was the stage even in 1972. And even in Supreme Court Bar Association, there were hardly 30, 40, they were enrolled 30 or 40, maybe 25, 30 women lawyers, but out of them, very few were practicing. Now the question arises, why was it so? It was obviously so because there were certain professions which were typecast for women, that either she has to go for a teaching profession, either she has to go for medical profession at the most, nursing or some profession which was carved out for women. So it has a historical background. Since I have been given only 20 minutes, I think I have to rush to the subject. So they were told that and very, very few judges. No, what I was trying to say was that, it became a news. It became a news in my hometown, state capital, that was Patna, that, and one of my friends said, "Oh, Gyan Sudha, wo Supreme Court chali gai practice karne. Supreme Court, aray, wo to ek din judge bhi ban jayegi." Why? Because I had a tough exterior right from my school days. What I mean to say is that if you are one of those normal girls and have an ambition, you go through a more of a tough time than I had gone through. And even in a place like Supreme Court, I was put the questions that if you are going to, how will you handle if you have a rape case? One of the former attorney generals, I would not name him, he says that you have joined the profession, what will you do if you have rape cases to handle, what will you do? And I gave the reply that there are not only rape cases which I have to handle, and if I don't feel comfortable, maybe I'll handle it, I'll pass on to some of my colleagues. But never did I know that for a rape, I will have to react in Nirbhaya even as a sitting judge. So these are the historical backgrounds. Now I would straight away come to the main theme of the subject, that women participation of women in judiciary, in the legal profession, why is it so? To my mind, you see, there is no dearth of talent. There is no dearth of merit, but the dearth is of confidence in the ability of women. The society do not have enough, you know, confidence in the ability of women. And I would illustrate you, even as a judge or even as an IAS officer, if you are there, you are given many a time soft jobs. Like, you know, one of my chief justice teased me once, oh, you are doing this, you are doing, just in a lighter way. And he said, tomorrow I'm going to give you the labor. No, he said, you know, I'll give you something very simple to do, that labor laws. I said, I'm looking forward for something more challenging. Labor laws, I don't want to keep counting 240 days. The experience, what I'm trying to say is that today we might be having women from bottom up to the top. We have from it's not very polite to say, but in lighter way, I say, chaprasi se rashtrapati. We have women at all levels. Now we are having women army officers, we have women fighter pilots also. But what is the second-rate citizen's attitude of society to treat women as a second-rate professional? Their ability, their confidence, how do we have to, this is what we need to deliberate, and what is the task when you hold these workshops through webinar or through seminar or conferences, we have to hammer that let there be acknowledgement of the woman of a woman's work, that she is equally capable. But having said that, I would also this might not be very palatable for my sister lawyers, if legal fraternity who are in the legal profession, that you must also will have to reflect quality in what you do. If you think that you are going to get anything on a platter, I think we are sadly mistaken. You will not get it on a platter unless you prove yourself. But there, the tears are shed by women. No. We have to prove. Even I've said many a time that women have to give, prove extra merit in themselves in order to get themselves elevated, etc. But the fact of the matter is that it's an old saying, all of us know, God helps those who help themselves. Women also will have to recognize and acknowledge that they cannot afford to be coy. They cannot afford to be compromising on quality. They cannot, if they are, right now, what is the, even at this stage, what is the image of the woman lawyer? That she is, she is running around a senior lawyer. How many, if you see the percentage, how many of them, even before becoming judges, women, some of the women judges, even before judges, they were juniors to some lawyers. Why this second rate status? For women also will have to contribute for themselves, that they will have to ensure quality. And fortunately, they are doing. It's not that it has grown over the years. The legal profession has grown over the years. And fortunately, if there are many women lawyers in the profession, obviously there will be quality also. But the Yaksha Prashna, the very monumental question is how to survive in the litigation. Because if you want to join, and the Vice Chancellor Sahab has rightly said that they come in the subordinate judiciary. Yes, they come in the subordinate judiciary by virtue of their merit and competition and going through the competitive examinations. But when you work as a lawyer on the litigation side, you are like an actor or actors in the film land. Your performance is seen by everyone. You are being judged by everyone. And I still feel that if you perform well, this is for the women folk, for the women lawyers, that they should not, mere ko to consider hi nahi karte, mere ko to consider nahi. Arey, you must reflect quality. And fortunately, the society has become conscious that if they see merit in the women, then sooner or later she gets acknowledged. So while on the one hand, I would say it's a dual thing. On the one hand, if society has to acknowledge the worth of a woman, it should not be if she's a lady lawyer or if she's a lady judge, to chalo chalta hai kind of a situation. Like women drivers on the road, they are perceived that they are bad drivers. That perception, it's a dual. Both the sides, the women, the girls, and the lady lawyers also have a responsibility to deliver quality in their work. But I know it's very easy to say that, but it's not. It's very difficult to survive on the litigation side, because litigation is that you get the. We all understand litigation is that it's an open profession where you have to set up your practice, and the difficulty is how to get the clientele, how to generate the clientele. But that, you know, because the judge in me says that it's not always good to criticize the society. You see, if there is difficulty in surviving and on the litigation side, it is difficult both ways. Even for men lawyers, it is difficult to survive on the litigation side. That is why many of them opt for law firms. Many men lawyers also say that I would very much want to go on the litigation side, but who is going to run my kitchen? Who is going to? So that is applicable to men and women both. But they have to, you know, deliver quality and side by side. Society also has to acknowledge the work, because even if you have reached at a point and then you are being treated as a second rate, in the sense that you will not be assigned duties which is worth of a woman judge to deliver, I think there is some problem lying in the mental mindset of the society also, and that needs to be hammered, that needs to be cracked, that you cannot, again from a personal memoir, I'm telling you something. I was recommended fairly at a very young age, and I did not get through at that time. I had to wait 8 long years because I was relatively only 37 when first time I was recommended, and even my family, my father said, no, you cannot make it at this stage. So I had to wait till the year 45 before I was elevated. But what I'm trying to tell you is, one of the my colleagues says, ki haan haan, log bolte hain ki if you are elevated, so you can be a good candidate among the women lawyers. And I must tell you, I was definitely put off. I said, and I have been a fighter in my life for for some reason it is thrust on me. So I said, you know, I have a good background, I have a good educational background, I have good exposure, I have been a good student, I have delivered results during my student days. What I am good or bad points, it's for everyone to see, because I appear in courts even in those days when there were not many women lawyers appearing in the Supreme Court and arguing matters. So the bottom line is, why do you have to say that agar inka selection hota hai, to she would be a good candidate among the women? That means even in spite of all my attributes, I was not parallel to two men. So there the problem arises, that if you are acknowledging, you know, an average lawyer as a male lawyer for elevation, then why do you not consider with her with the average lawyer of that, at least to that extent? So these are the but I would not be despondent, I would not be pessimistic about it. I'm sure things are changing, it will change, and in the change the women also will have to, like, they cannot afford to be casual. And in the process, there are so many, you know, so many issues as to how to be serious, because they have to balance their life, their domestic, their personal family life also. Supposing a girl is doing very well in the profession and she has a match where the family insists that no, you must marry, and then she has to relocate. You would be knowing about the former Chief Justice, she is no more, Justice Leela Seth. She was practicing wherever her husband was transferred. So she, in that process, she practiced in Calcutta High Court, she practiced in Patna High Court. Finally, she came to Delhi High Court. Now, and many a times I have been asked, I've been put this question, ma'am, how have you balanced your life? I said, if I tell you my, personal journey to this, you will know ki humne bhi bahut lohe ke chande chabaye hain. And sometimes, someday, if I write my like one of the judicial officer, because he thodi si unhone chutki li mere upar, because I come, as I said, I come from a family of judges. He said, aapko to plate mein saja karke judge pila. And I was so, I said, please don't say that. I came from a relatively, state capital city. And when I came to this Delhi Supreme Court Bar Association, after 21 years of my father's retirement, I was nobody in the Supreme Court. So I had my own, personal battle to handle. So please don't say, I may not, theek hai, mujhe, I didn't have to pay the rent, house rent. I didn't have to pay for the kitchen, because that was taken care of by my respected parents. Maybe I wouldn't have been able to survive in Delhi at that stage. So these are the, fortunately, girls are very smart these days. They tackle all these aspects. But while tackling all these aspects, they also have a lot of, zeal to, but as I said, Yaksha Prashna, that monumental question, how to get the work. And how to get the work, and then when you are established, if you have to relocate. So on the personal front and the professional front, she has to do boxing both ways. And that is how her performance, it becomes, some of them opt out, some of them leave the profession. It's only a very 10% of them who stick to the profession, and there also they are treated as if second rate. So summarizing my thoughts on the participation of women, I think we all need to make our efforts bit by bit to change that mindset, where women should not be taken as, at least when they are reached at a level. But how to increase their participation in the higher judiciary, I don't think that reservation or anything can be the solution. And higher judiciary will never accept reservation. So I don't quite approve, I don't think that women for all the time should look for crutches. They should not look for crutches. They must build quality in them and then fight it out. If they have quality and yet they are ignored, I think their voice definitely will carry some weight. And sooner or later, they do get recognized. Now, litigation, as I said, if you want to opt out for litigation, but then initially you might work for a few years in a law firm and then switch over to the litigation, but you must have the aptitude for litigation. And I've also found that women, litigation side, when they practice, many a time, they have a court fear. They are scared of the proving their point in the court. Many times they are too much polite also. They are not aggressive enough. Aggressive doesn't mean that you have to be aggressive with your to be impolite or rude to the court. You have to, again, a balance between putting across your point, but with, with grace and dignity. So these are my random thoughts regarding, because many aspects I have not touched, because you already know how, collegium and the collegium system is there. But collegium system, you cannot say that you make a reservation, because that has to be a policy decision at the government level. So, and I personally feel that, instead of going for all that, women must get quality education at all levels. Quality education at all levels. They do not have to sacrifice. Even the, you know, if you can run some courses for the advocates training, there are not very many. There are a few, but not very many. So, and maybe we can talk, like I one at some point of time as a sitting judge, I had given a suggestion that every senior advocate under the IT Act or every professional must give a certificate that you have trained so many juniors, and they must also pay them and must get their fee. Of course, they do. They might be getting it because when you give in your income tax return, you say you have paid so much. But many a time that's on paper. That's not on reality. So something should be done that doesn't remain on paper, because the most difficult aspect of a legal profession for anyone, for a boy or a girl, if he wants to go in for the litigation, how to engage, keep herself engaged, is a very difficult part of the profession. But it's not that it, if you pursue, then ultimately, if you keep on walking, you reach the destination also. So right today, I have, you know, given you only my random thoughts. There are some judgments, like, you know, Mrs. Samiran was mentioning about one of my, I'm happy that you have mentioned at least one judgment other than Arunav Shanbhag and BCCI, because whenever I party, only these two judgments are mentioned. And I'm very passionate about one judgment, which is, I'm forgetting the name, that is relating to 494 of the RPC, where a man makes the woman believe that she is his legally married wife, cohabits and then deserts her, then an offense is made out. And before I complete my my deliberations, I feel tempted to share this. I tell you because, you know, if you are a magistrate, then my co-judge, Justice Cardew, said, no, that lady knew that she is illegally. That's a reported judgment, went to the larger bench. Maybe later I can recollect the cause title. Right now I don't recollect the cause title. So he said, no, the woman knew that she is not his legally married wife. So how will the offense under 494 is made out? And my view was that no, 494, if you were a magistrate, because they are bound by the law, codified law, enacted law of CRPC, IPC, etc. But at a level of the Supreme Court, we have to interpret the law. So that man actually was living with that lady for 15 years. They had two children out of their relationship, and they were from an Adivasi community. Later on, I learned that they also have, you know, they also customary marriage among the Adivasis, that they, even they have not formally married, then they can have the family. The children's father's name was that man, and he deserted and took the plea that no, she is not my legally married wife. And therefore, 494 offences not made out, and he wanted to get away. Please, Samreen, I have noticed that perhaps you are interested in some offbeat judgments also. I will let you know through the moderator of this program, Abhishek. I will let you know the judgment. Please publicize the judgment. Please publicize the judgment. That 494 and that 494 is made out in my view, and it's a larger bench judgment. In spite of that, one of the lower subordinate judiciary officers in Delhi did not take that interpretation and went into something else. That no, it's not made out. It's not made out. Are you have been living with that woman for the last 15 years, having children, and then you say you are not legally married wife merely because the marriage was not registered. This is absolutely ridiculous in my view. But fortunately for me, that difference of opinion, because I myself and Justice Cardew, we differed, it went to the larger bench, and larger bench upheld my view. And that was a great moment for me, not for myself, that I proved my point, but women will be secured from getting exploited. A man will have to think 1,000 times before exploiting a woman, cheating her by making her believe that she's a legally married wife. But having said all this, a bit of a upadesh is there for girls also. Please don't allow yourself to be exploited. I will end up my deliberations and my thought process. Please be strong. Please be strong all the time and don't allow yourself to be exploited. If you do that, you will be doing, first of all, justice to yourself. You have to, first of all, deliver justice to yourself than anyone else. Now, I think I've taken more than my time, allotted time, but I'm very passionate about this. And that is why sometimes, you know, more than the required, maybe if I've, you know, cut short my autobiography part, then I could have, you know, taken more on the judgment. So looking forward to meet you all. Thanks a lot, Vice Chancellor Sapko and all, and thanks to Abhishek also for pursuing and making me join the program. No, and he's been rather pursuing since long for several months. I said, please, I've been doing so many webinars these years, I'm getting fed up. So please spare me for some time. Then he said, no, you can give me after some time. So after some break, today I'm joining this program after some break. And it's a very happy moment that at least, you know, if I share my experience, I at least that also a part of your journey, which you are going to undertake. Best wishes, wish all the girls, all the budding lawyers a great future, and wish you all the best, men lawyers and women lawyers both. Because I believe in equality. I believe in equality to one and all, not only women. All the best. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. We are highly honored to have you here. And thank you for sharing your wonderful insights to us. Now, I would like to request Ms. Kanika Singh to impart her knowledge about today's theme.
Hi, and good evening to all. I have a very tough job of following that stellar act from ma'am. In fact, ma'am's been an inspiration and is a great role model for the topic that we're speaking on, and has paved the way that we can, in fact, reach a stage where we can have discussions like today's. I would also like to thank the wonderful faculty at the university, the Vice Chancellor Saab, Simri ma'am, and all of them, and the Law Culture, the folks, at very kind folks at Law Culture, for making this.
Can I interrupt you for a second? I had
absolutely
mentioned Abhishek. I should have mentioned Animesh. boy who was pursuing me. Many thanks.
Right.
Yes, please go ahead.
Right. So Animesh, you have our thanks twice over, and ma'am's put that thank on record again. So now, before going any further, this is a topic that's extremely close to my heart, and it's still relevant. And I'm going to be speaking at it more from the litigation perspective. Ma'am's taken us through the judiciary perspective, and ma'am's the way ma'am's achieved what she has, and the struggles that continue to be there right now. I will be speaking on the topic largely based on my experience as a litigating lawyer in the High Court of Delhi for the last 11 years, and what I have learned and observed in the past. So first, for some good news. And the good news has been that I have discovered that it is possible, largely not handicapped by gender, to carve a successful practice for yourself, at least in the Delhi High Court. This might be an experience which is limited to a larger city and might not be possible maybe in a different town, a smaller town. However, certain things are possible. You can carve a niche for yourself. You can be taken seriously. You can look forward to be even be involved in bar politics or any other activities that might interest you. And all of that has been made possible by women like ma'am here and several other women who made it possible for, who opened the doors for us. And now we are there to be taken a little more seriously. Now that we have the good news out of the way, there is still a lot that needs to be considered. And there are times where gender does enter the discussion, and I'm going to briefly deal with some of them that you might face. One thing ma'am mentioned when she was speaking was about how we need to be assertive and are not assertive. another counterpoint to that is when we are assertive, we are taken to. When a man is making his point, that is not a question. He's taken to be a good lawyer. But when a woman makes it, and sorry to use the vernacular, I have to be labeled as lada, argumentative.
I endorse what you are saying, Kanika.
Absolutely, ma'am. A prejudice that is still there. And so that is something you'll have to deal with a lot of grace, to not get intimidated by the commentary, to not take reactions like that to heart, to not let go of the fact that you want to make your point as passionately as possible with all respect to the bench and the opposite side. But don't listen to anybody who calls you argumentative in a negative way or seeks to pull you down on that. Thing that you should be concerned about, do your bit. Another way in which gender I think is still relevant is we have posts like lady member executive. In fact, when I was planning to contest elections, I was for the Delhi High Court Bar Association, I was told, why should I not limit myself to the lady member executive post? Why we look at general posts, because there's one post earmarked for women. And that post is still relevant. We're not at that stage where we can let those posts go. But thankfully, we've reached that stage that we can look to contest for other positions. Having said that, ma'am's well aware, we've never had a female Chief Justice of India. Similarly, we've never had a female chairperson of the Bar Council of Delhi, never had any female president, at least of the Delhi High Court Bar Association. So there are several posts and spheres which are still barriers that I hope many of you who follow us will be able to shed, and in fact make sure that those are not statistics that we quote say 5 to 6 or maybe even 10 years from now, and those are statistics that are changed. Another feature in which when this is what Samreen ma'am also said, and then ma'am took it forward as to being the female consciousness being there on the bench and on in this side as well. Recently, we have the Committee on Reforms in Criminal Law, and there's not a single representation by any woman, female on the said committee. And this is a committee which will be deciding reforms on criminal law, on offenses, a lot of which might be offenses against women. And yet they do not feel, even in 2020, the need to have a female voice on it. There is always going to be that struggle that we don't want to be included only as a token voice, but at the same time, we don't want decisions that affect us to be taken without our representation. Another thing as a litigating lawyer that I've struggled is being commented on your appearance. In the sense, sometimes if you've been told to dress down, you've been told, and I love wearing suits and all of that, it makes practical sense to be wearing that in Delhi in the heat, but you often get told, when I was contesting elections, I was told, commented on my campaign photo, that I put too bright a color lipstick in it, and I was told that that's not something that I should be doing. So little things like that will also be part of the commentary that you might hear. Again, I strongly believe you should be presentable, and other than that, your work will speak for yourself. There might be gossip, there might be some sort of chit chatter. It's best to ignore that and continue forging your way forward. What ma'am also highlighted is the very high attrition rate we have in this profession. Women join, we join at the college level, as I think the Vice Chancellor Saab also said, that at the college level right now, the participation is quite high. But as we go higher and further, less and less women enter litigation anyway, and then less and less women manage to survive in litigation. That's not only a women-centric actual statistic. A lot of even men fall on the wayside because litigation is a very tough taskmaster. But regardless, I think the situation is changing. Court, as a litigating, female litigating lawyer, you will get an equal opportunity of putting across your case. You will be considered on the basis of your arguments that you're advancing. There might be a little patronizing here and there, which happens to all of us as we progress. But by and large, it is a lot has changed. Earlier, now the number of senior advocates that we have is also rising, and hopefully as more and more women make it in litigation, that will continue to change. Earlier, when I just joined the profession, there were very few female senior advocates that we could look up to as role models. That has definitely changed, and hopefully it will continue to change. One other thing that I strongly feel is that there's so much emphasis, and this is in fact, now we are moving towards what can be done in terms of going forward. There's a lot that we keep hearing about the old boys club and about how men stick to themselves. I think growing forward, women, especially litigating lawyers, please network, please make sure that you community, because we're all sharing this experience together and we can only help each other. So it's important to be connected and to have a vibrant community of female lawyers as part of the greater bar that is there, and use that experience. In addition, I would suggest that certain generic things, as ma'am said, sometimes you might have to work extra hard, twice as hard, maybe not twice now, maybe lesser. Ma'am has made possible, ma'am and others like ma'am have made possible, that it's not twice as hard now, but it's still a little harder than sometimes the male colleagues. So as long as you're putting in that hard work, and increasingly today, ma'am also referred to advocacy skills, but there's so many ways in which you can skill yourself and put yourself out there. The law culture being an example of how young students, starting from young students, now students are more awoke as to how to pitch themselves out. It is a profession where you have to constantly sell yourself in terms of making yourself viable as somebody that somebody, the client wants to put their trust in. So make sure that you're upskilling yourself. Make sure you're involved in writing articles and being involved. It is a case, litigation takes time. When we joined the profession, we were told there's a gestation period of 3 years, then it became 5 years, then it became 6 to 7 years. And I think even now, I still think that I'm still settling in. So it's a long gestation period, made sometimes a little longer by the fact that you might be a woman in the profession. But honestly, at least in the Delhi High Court, it can happen. You can set up a good practice, carve out a name for yourself and make it work. Lastly, one other thing, sometimes you might feel that clients find it easier. And now that is, I think, at least in my experience, it's lessening. But earlier, it was easier to go to a male counsel, especially on important matters or the matters that they thought women counsels couldn't handle as well. So don't get disheartened if that is the case or if that ever happens to you, because increasingly it's becoming rarer, at least in the High Court. They take you seriously. They will come to you for merits if you've proven in the past to be successful. As long as your hard works are there, as long as you're putting in the hours, you will be taken seriously. So that's just my two bits from the litigation side, from my experience in the Delhi High Court largely. The situation is getting better and will continue to get better. And hopefully there'll be a day where topics like today might in fact become redundant. It's not happening anytime soon, but that's the dream that I'm sure all of us have, that it will be a point where we can look at participation of women as just participation, without labeling it as women participation or male participation, just looking at it as women. As in fact, this is the week, this is the month that we lost one of the great voices in the US Supreme Court, which was Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who very famously replied when she was asked as to how many women should be there in the Supreme Court in the US. And she said, there'll be enough when there are 9, which is the total strength of the Supreme Court. So that's the way it should be. You shouldn't be thinking about what will be enough, because it should not be a point of discussion. We should aim that it reaches a point that nobody thought for so long that having only men in the Supreme Court was not a big deal. So let's dream to make it as far as possible, extensive participation across all spheres. And whenever you encounter a glass ceiling, essentially those instances of encountering a glass ceiling are lessening. But if you do encounter one such ceiling, then with all the grace and all the persuasion and all the aggression at your disposal, please push through because increasingly there are cracks in that glass and it is going to break. So to all students out there, the future is extremely bright as a female in litigation, and in fact as any lawyer in litigation. So thank you. That's my two bits and this. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Very well said. Thank you for sharing your knowledge and imparting us and telling us about theme. Now, I would like to request Samreen ma'am to put forth the questions to the panel. Samreen ma'am.
Problem with RML network. I'm trying to connect. I am connected. Am I connected, Shubhangi?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Okay, thank you Kanika, thank you ma'am. So there are a few questions from our viewers. The first question is from Sasi Prakash, and she asks, can reserving some percentage of position of judge in Supreme Court for women be a solution, or would compulsory reservation have some implication on merits?
Is this question meant for me?
It's meant for both of you, actually. What are your opinions? Do you think there can be reservation possible?
Let Kanika address on this first.
Okay, Kanika ma'am.
Spoke a little long. Ma'am said reservations, in fact, not a solution to a large extent. We do. It is a. It's an office which has a tremendous responsibility that it discharges. And so it is important that women rise up to the challenge and upskill them and be participating there. But I agree with ma'am on this, that just a simple reservation would not be, would want an instance.
I think I have already disclosed myself. You are right. I went to the extent of saying that women should not run on move on crutches.
Yes, ma'am. There is one question, and that is from my side, actually. For the last few days, I have been generally reading. I am writing a paper, generally reading. So I've been reading about harassment at the Supreme Court or the High Courts, and especially at district courts. Here we are talking about sexual harassment as well as harassment with regard to in gender. So my question is, is it there? It might be there, but what proportion is there? And it is because more with regard to women that it is there, or in general the profession is such that people think that it's harassment. You know, and there are particularly there is one more opinion that because female themselves think that they have been targeted, and that's not the case. And there is another feminist school which believe that they are being genuinely targeted because of this. This is the easiest way. As Kanika herself pointed out, the shade of lipstick, commenting upon the attire, commenting upon how you speak is general sense. So do you think it's there, or it's just, as we say, we perceive it? And I also like answer from Kanika too. Ma'am, please.
Actually, your voice was cracking, so I don't. What exactly do you want to know? Are you wanting to know the remedy, or want to, or like what exactly?
The first,
can you
listen, the simple question is, first The first that one simple question is that is exist does harassment of this kind exist? Does we can say that sexual harassment exists?
You see, if I will not be able to say much about the current situation because I left the bar more than 25 years ago. So 25 years ago, you know, because my experience is only in the Supreme Court and a few high courts. So in Supreme Court, the atmosphere was excellent in the bar during those times. And I still, what I get a feel from the places that I don't think there's any harassment kind of a situation in the bar. And that's how, you know, I had a very happy experience. Nor did I ever encounter a snide remark or anything. I don't know what was the reason, I don't know. But I think it's, you know, I don't think there's any woman who has not suffered, you know, harassment at some point of her life, maybe large or small. But that is, when I say that, those are the isolated ones. Because, you know, you get so many, even in school when you study, there are very many, in colleges when you study, there are, most of them are good, but there are just a 1 or 2%, by and large, I have not heard of any harassment in my experience. I think Kanika would be able to highlight more on this because she is now of the present generation. Because as I said, you know, I have, like, Supreme Court bar was excellent. Rather, in the they would want to include women in every executive committee. But yes, there was, you know, of course, this is not related to your question. But even in Supreme Court bar, they want to give women a secondary position. Fortunately, now they accept, because I also contested some of the bar elections in the Supreme Court long ago. They would accept you as a member of the executive committee. They will accept you as long as vice and assistant is added. Fortunately, they are now accepting secretary, but they will accept you as vice president. They will accept you as assistant secretary, but they will not accept you as secretary. So that kind of harassment is there. Oh, madam, you are contesting assistant. Oh, you are contesting for secretary. But fortunately, there is a change. Now they are accepting a secretary. But so far, president of the Supreme Court Bar Association so far has not been any woman so far. So harassment is in the mind. But so far as though, you know, cheap, if you mean by harassment, though, like, you know, those cheap and like, at least I belong to a fortunate generation. It was a very cultured generation in the legal profession, although people had apprehensions about it. But if it is there, then how should it be dealt with is a more, you know, that needs to be addressed. And Kanika would be able to say, I don't think, my guess is that it's not there even now. But.
You're inaudible, Samreen ma'am.
Yeah, I would only add that at the district court level, and no one would dare to do this with the judges, but district court or the magistrate court, what women go through, I think it needs some research.
Ma'am, there is a question from Shashank Pandey. He asks, we see low judiciary because of equal opportunities in competition, that there is higher percentage of women. However, at higher judiciary stage, where collegium is involved, we see less of female recommendation. So, what can be the reason? Yeah, she said that
he's correct. He's correct in his, you know, observations. But you know, when I deliberate about that aspect, one of the reasons is that there in the High Court level, and as also in the Supreme Court level, the number of women is distinguishing themselves and catching attention is not that large compared to, if there are 100 men lawyers who are catching attention, there would be only 5 women lawyers who are there. So in that sense, so at the collegium level, maybe some introspection and some, maybe it's required. It's required. It's, I would not say it's not required. And what he's reacting is not too unfounded. But that is for, it's a very complex question, I must say.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
You will have to invite the collegium judges to get an answer on this.
I would love to do that. We would seriously love to do this. Thank you.
I share his concern, and I have shared my experience also. How the perception goes, you may be good, but you may be good among the women judges. You have to be equally good, as good as a male. I can say so many things. I think it will need another session. So I would stop at that. But I appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
And I cannot give you a remedy, because National Judicial Appointment Commission was made. Then the matter was debated in the case. And now, just for one single individual, even though I have been a judge of the topmost court, so I will have to bada gaye to bhejo aaye. I don't have the so I can only share. But I appreciate it. I repeatedly.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, everyone. Now I would like. Now I would request Honorable Justice Gyanchuda Mishra, ma'am, to share her final remarks in today's session.
It's a without doubt, it has been a very, very deeply involved session, and whatever the speakers have said, it did not have tokenism. You know, most of the program, in one of the programs which I attended, and mostly when they are lawyers and judges and academicians in the connected with law. I think it's never an academician, but you, please don't mind my saying, but if it is someone who is, not connected with law, that tokenism and pampering of women is there. Oh, there, jatra naryastu pujante ramante tatra devta, yani jahan naru ki puja hoti hai, wahan devta ka vas hota hai, aur mahilayen to bahut sahanshil hoti, because the other day, I had to do some plain speaking where two vice chancellors, one from a Sanskrit university and one former vice chancellor. I had to do some plain speaking. He said that, I've heard this ever since, jab se humne hosh samala, I've been hearing this. But, this tokenism is not going to do, you will have to think what you are doing to women. And yes, they are. And I also say, and I also would like to, for the girls, that whatever is your natural virtues of tolerance, of family values, there should be there. But there has to be a limit to tolerance also. But, and you must have the wisdom to draw a line between tolerance and tolerance of atrocity. So, and I think with education, it actually, but I'm hopeful, as long as you get exposure, as you get good education, you get good opportunity, good opportunity, of course, in litigation is a is a difficult matter, as you all understand, for girls as well as for boys. But for other parts, you know, I think if a, is given a good education and good training, perhaps, you know, we are having moot courts right now. But apart from moot court competition in law schools, if there are some training in curriculum, some training also is introduced, maybe that can do some good. So quality education is the answer to everything, because you know, long ago I had gone to Harvard University just for a, you know, not for a lecture or anything. I just had gone there. In fact, one my host said, "Ki aapne wahan kya karke jana?" I said, "I want to go to Boston." I was in New York at that time. It was a long ago this happened. So she said, "Aapne kya wahan jaake padhai karni hai? Why do you want to go to Boston and Harvard, like Harvard and MIT?" I said, "Nahi, jahan itne dino se suna hai, like, you know, I heard so much about this these institutions. To I wahan ki hawa laga lete." So one of my host, another host, she was a young girl. I asked her this question: "Ki, why do we need to come to Harvard? Why do we need to come to MIT? Like, you know, it's not that is something they come out with some short formula." But she gave a very convincing answer. And she was related to it. She said, "Auntie, Harvard, when people come to Harvard, it's the confidence which matters. It's the confidence which gives an institution, like, you know, it's all we, why is there, you know, what is the difference between a dhaba and this thing? It's the confidence. And you get a brand, and brand gives you confidence. That is how you need a quality institute." And therefore, I would also like to impress upon, because there are some educational, you know, personnel also in from the institution, it's the quality of the education. You must have a brand, you know, there are mushrooming of colleges, but you must have a brand value. Why only? And I tell you, you know, I never, I might, you know, decline an invitation from a premier law institute, but I never decline an invitation from a so-called, you know, relatively lesser known institution, because they don't get that exposure. Why should I accept the invitation only when I have to go to National Law School, Bangalore, or National School ABCD? We must also get, look here, judges, like even women judges or any judge for that matter, you know, wo bhi hard man's ke putle hote. Like in one of my deliberations, I think it was in long ago in Pune, they were so overwhelmed. I said, "If I can make it, you can make it too. Mere bhi do aankh hain, do kaan hain, do haath hain. If I can make it, you can make it too." So chase the quality. And chasing the quality, the responsibility lies on the institution also, how to give them maximum opportunity to improve their skills and to gain confidence that, look here, what are you going to do? I will give you brand by my performance. So it's like that. In the process, I'm forgetting your question also. What was the question?
There was no question.
Concluding remarks.
You know,
we become so confident that we become hyper informal also. So, what exactly was your concern? Tell me.
Ma'am, concluding remarks on today's webinar.
Okay. So, today's remarks, it was not a lip service. It was not a lip service today. All the speakers spoke of the practical aspects, and it was not theoretical at all. And therefore, it contributes, the inputs that we have shared will compel you to think and improve the quality of education. Overall, I think, because when we share the experience, you also know how to improve and how to, you know. So the speakers, especially Kanika also, you know, she shared her thought. You have to think now as a student community, you will have to think, why is it that there is more of acceptability of women in all professions, including legal profession, in metros, and not so much in relatively so-called smaller cities. I don't treat them as smaller. After all, you know, when they say it's a small town, what do you mean by small town, small town? They are the state capitals. They represent the entire state. But I think there is difference in mindset. I think the other day I wrote, I read one of the reactions of the Leela said that when she was, when she had gone to Himachal, so people had a feeling that how come a woman is at her head? Is woman at her head as an Indian? And you say we have enough of serious things. Now let us have some lighter moments. I will share one experience as Chief Justice in the Ranchi High Court. And there were some issues about transfer of the judicial officers, district judges from one place to the other. And I said, you know, I've heard something about such and such officer and he needs to go from there. And obviously he was upset. And people of that area were very keen that this officer should be removed from that place. Now, one of the headmasters of a school had come on a courtesy call to tell me, to put across the point that the judicial officer should be shifted from there. But they did not have the confidence in me because I was a woman chief justice. And I tell you what comment was made. कि ये बोलते हैं कि ये क्या ट्रांसफर करेंगे जुडिशियल ऑफिसर का एंड एक गवई कहावत उन्होंने बोला लहरनी से कि गाछ कटेला आई एम नाउ ट्रांसलेटिंग इट फॉर यू लहरनी इज दैट यू नो विद अ नाई जो नाखून वाखून लाइक यू नो लाइक नेल कटर एथनिक नेल कटर यू कैन थिंक So nail that was used for cutting the nails by a nai while cutting the hair, etc. So that is called laharni. So he meant to say ki woman chief justice is a laharni. She cannot cut a tree. We need even for, you see, I had all the authority. Even my, you know, whisper would have been enough to throw him out of that place. But see the mindset. Now, that mindset is not there in the metro. That's not in Delhi. That is why Kanika is fortunate not to suffer discrimination when she's practicing in Delhi High Court. Even I did not have the guts to start my practice at a smaller place. Now, that mindset has to be percolated at all levels and in all cities. And when we do that, we have to do it with sincerity. So, in today's program, I must say that, you know, sincerity should reflect in what you do in future. We have done the theory part, we have discussed it, but ensure that the masses are educated about it, that small little town also should shed that, should be able to shed that discrimination from their mind. Discrimination should go, first of all, from the mind. In that sense, I appreciate and hail your effort of this webinar. And keep doing your bit, and that of course will convert in Delhi. We have so many programs. It's good it's happening in Lucknow. Maybe you can have it in a official town, perhaps when things are, you know, calm down in the sense that we are not affected with corona. Have the workshops at a smaller places. Of course, legal services authority is also doing all this, but more of it is required. So, all the best.
Thank you, ma'am, for passing on your knowledge to us. Now, I would like to request Dr. Manish Singh, Chairperson of Legal Aid Committee, to present his vote of thanks.
Thank you, Shubhangi. This indeed has been an extremely enriching experience, listening to the ideas, views, and experiences shared by someone of such a high stature as Honorable Justice Gyansudha Mishra. Gender disparity, both on the legal front and otherwise, has been a recurrent problem which has been stifling our society from developing at a pace at which it should. Honorable Justice Mishra has been an institution in herself, and her words of wisdom and encouragement
will surely encourage the youth of today to embrace the legal profession and fulfill their innate desire to excel in life and also to be useful and productive to the society, as has their role model. We are highly indebted to her and show our heartfelt gratitude for sparing moments from her precious time to us. Thank you, ma'am. I also extend my heartfelt thanks to Ms. Kanika Singh, a dynamic and vibrant lawyer who has very well complimented Honorable Justice in this discourse. Such discussions are important since it will help the current generation break out of the shadow of inequality and help them to formulate their ideas to decrease the wide gap of gender disparity. In this respect, I would say, a tremendous responsibility also lies on the male counterpart of the fraternity to provide a safe, congenial, and friendly environment to the fellow female lawyers and officers of the court. I also thank the chief patron of our most respected Vice Chancellor, who always has rendered his active support in all our endeavors, whether they be curricular, co-curricular, or extracurricular. Many thanks also to Dr. Samreen Hussain, who has moderated this session excellently. I'll be failing in my duty if I'll not acknowledge the efforts of the student members of the Legal Aid Committee of Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia National Law University and the Law Culture, who with the minimal resources at their disposal, organized such an excellent program. I again extend my heartfelt gratitude towards the esteemed participants and the panelists for enthralling us with their enlightening words and rich experiences. Thank you, everyone, for making it a fruitful session. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, everyone, for joining us.
Thank you very much. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am, for sharing your views.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Can I leave the meeting now?
Yes. Okay. Thank you.
Yes, yes, yes.
But I have to push that button. Okay. Looking forward to more of interaction. And all the best for the institute.
Thanks.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you, participants, for joining us for this session. We thank the Law Culture, LAC and NLU Lucknow, and the panelists for enriching our thoughts today. The Law Culture hopes to bring you more such sessions and content that will help you. Thank you.